This is Science Friday. I'm Ira Plato, and it's time once again for our Charismatic Creature Carnival. I love that music.
Never gets old.
No, and joining me today, as always, is our Charismatic Creature correspondent, producer Kathleen Davis. Hi, Kathleen.
Hey there, Ira. Glad to be back.
Now, I'm sad to say that this is, what, our last matchup for the carnival this fall?
It sure is. If you are just learning about SciFri's Charismatic Creature Carnival, over the last month, we've been celebrating six underappreciated and perhaps unconventional creatures. And because we love a little competition, we've been doing these head-to-head matches between two of them to determine our semifinalists. Next week, our listeners will vote for their favorite of the semifinalists, and we will have our first ever audience-chosen entry of our Charismatic Creature Corner Hall of Fame.
Whoa, Creature Corner Hall of Fame. I can't wait for that one. And I hear that we also have an update about last week. Tell us.
Yes. So if you remember, last week's matchup was between the opossum and the aye-aye. Our listeners went to sciencefriday.com/carnival to vote for their favorite. I'm going to be honest, people felt very strongly about this matchup one way or another, but the votes don't lie. And we do have a winner, Ira. So I would like a drum roll, please.
Here we go, the best I can.
Crawling into our second semi-finalist spot to join the mantis shrimp as a Charismatic Creature Carnival semi-finalist, the people's choice is the opossum.
Best symbols I can do. Sorry about that. I have to say, this is kind of surprising.
That noise also sounded a little bit like an opossum, I'll say. But SciFri listeners love the opossum, I've learned.
Wow. Okay. So who are our Charismatic Creature candidates for this week?
So this is our last matchup of the carnival. So really soak it in, Ira. We're celebrating our feathered friends this week. So our first creature joining us from your nearest city, perhaps even the fire escape outside your window, the ever-present yet mystifying pigeon. The pigeon was nominated by listener Greg from Spring, Texas. Greg calls himself your friendly neighborhood pigeon man. That is his name on Twitter. And he left us this message on our SciFri VoxPop app.
I nominated the pigeon for the Charismatic Creature Carnival because they are the most overlooked animal on the planet. They are actually one of the most intelligent birds and one of the most intelligent animals around, and they can recognize words, and they recognize themselves in the mirror, and they have an incredible homing ability, and I hope they win.
You know, I would not have picked a pigeon to be a Charismatic Creature candidate. So, okay, Greg is making sort of he's opened the argument. Show us who the competitor is.
Yes, so representing the pigeon in the Charismatic Creature Carnival is Dr. Elizabeth Carlen, postdoctoral research fellow at Washington University in St. Louis. Welcome, Elizabeth.
Thank you so much for having me.
And facing off against the pigeon, a truly incomparable and mysterious creature you would be lucky to see for yourself. It is the one and the only Shoebill Stork. A couple of people nominated the Shoebill Stork for our carnival, including listener Eric. He wrote us an email and said, "The Shoebill Stork is, in my opinion, the most charismatic and weird bird that's living on the planet. It kind of looks like a dinosaur and clacks its beak to make a very strange noise. And it looks a little bit out of time with how big and awkward they are. They are amazing," says Eric.
Yeah, well, let's see how amazing and impressive they are. So let's see what happens.
Yep. Representing the Shoebill Stork in our carnival is Judith Mirembe, Shoebill researcher and chair of Uganda Women Birders, based in Kampala, Uganda. Welcome, Judith.
Hey, I'm glad to be here. I'm so excited for this special.
Well, we're very excited to have you and actually excited to have both of you here to help us wrap up the carnival. Just a quick note, this segment was recorded in front of a live Zoom audience. And for more information about how to join a future live recording, go to sciencefriday.com/livestream. Okay, enough with the preliminaries. Let the competition begin.
Okay, let's start with the basics here. That's what we always do with our carnival. Elizabeth, this might be a silly question, but as a radio show, we have to ask you, please describe the pigeon for us.
So pigeons are a medium-sized bird. They're about the size of a football, and they are found all across the world, except for Antarctica, every continent. And you can find them in cities. You can find them in along grain transportation routes. They are usually often the kind of default is gray with two black bars on their wings. However, there's a whole variety of colors that we can get into why that's happening. You might see some red pigeons or some all white pigeons. And that's kind of one of the interesting things I think about them is just that massive variety in plumage color or feather color. And you probably see them walking along the street quite a bit. They're maybe not always up in the air. I've seen pigeons taking the steps, very civilized, hopping up and down the steps as I commute to work. So they're one of these kind of very, to me, special creatures that lives in the city alongside us.
Okay, so much for the description of the pigeon. Judith, your turn. What? Give us a good description of a shoebill stork.
So the shoebill is it's a large gray bird with a shoe-shaped bill from where the name is derived from, making it a shoebill. So if you see anything that has a bill that looks like a shoe and you find it in Africa, you just know that is a shoebill. So they are quite large and with a height of about 110, 140 centimeters. The wingspan is almost twice the height. They live in wetland habitats, freshwater wetlands. In Africa, you'll not find them elsewhere outside Africa except in a zoo. So in Africa, you'll find them in Uganda, Botswana, in Rwanda, Ethiopia, Southern Sudan currently has the highest population. You'll find them in Zambia, in the Republic of Congo, Central African Republic, and about 8 countries. I don't know how many I've managed to mention. Yeah, so the shoebill, some people think it is a stork because of the appearance, but the closest relatives are the pelicans. So the shoebill falls alone in its family and has been closely related by genetics related to the pelicaniforms. So the closest relative of a shoebill is a hammercop, Yeah, that's all I can say about the shoebill.
So for our American audiences, when I look at a picture of a shoebill stork, to me, it looks a lot like Big Bird from Sesame Street. Our listener, Eric, said in his nomination that he thinks it looks a little bit like a dinosaur. I mean, Judith, what is it like to see a shoebill stork in the wild?
The first time you see it, the reaction is always, wow, the size. It's very large and definitely looks like a dinosaur, something you've never seen before. The cryptic color of the feathers among the papyrus strands and other wetland vegetation make it hard to see. So by the time you see it, you get astonished, you get surprised, and you just love what you see because of the size. So when you, the first encounter, what usually is done on a boat, on a canoe, to wade through the wetland, so you can get very close. And when you get very close, it's always astonishing to see it in the floating vegetation, despite the size. Yeah.
Wow, that's a great description. Elizabeth, I know that pigeons are found, just about everywhere. You see them in large urban cities. You see them all over the place. Why are they so adaptable? What makes them so adaptable?
Pigeons have been evolving alongside humans for the past 5 to 10,000 years. They are native to North Africa and Southern Europe and the Middle East, where we started farming grains. and they started living alongside humans. And because of that, that close relationship with humans, they've moved with us. We have brought pigeons with us as we colonized every kind of part of this world. And what do we do in New York with our trash? We put it out on the street. And that makes this perfect buffet for pigeons and rats. But for pigeons to kind of eat this food, have access to this food, and then we build these tall buildings which mimic the cliff sides that they lived on in their natural habitat, in their native habitat. And so you'll often see pigeons nesting on air conditioning units or inside of an awning or kind of any of these big high up places that protect them from these predators. And our buildings really provide that perfect place for them to be, along with these food sources that we're providing them. We also, there's something about feeding a pigeon that is very communal, that dropping a couple of chips and feeding this bird is, I think, something that we all connect with. If you think back to movies like Mary Poppins or Home Alone, there's some joy in feeding these pigeons because it connects us with this nature.
So we have our first listener question. A student in Mr. Boreas's class has a question about pigeons here in the U.S. Go ahead.
Shady, you want to ask our question?
Yes, go for it.
Oh, our students are shy, so maybe I'll read it. We had two questions. We were wondering, we learned that there are 12 subspecies of pigeons, but which subspecies do we have here in the United States? And also, what was the original habitat of pigeons before they became domesticated?
Great questions.
Yeah. Okay, so subspecies, let's start with that one. That one's kind of a difficult question for me personally as an evolutionary biologist, because they're just ways for us to name different kind of lineages or strains of pigeons. So in what I would kind of think of as, we have dog breeds. So there's different kinds of breeds of pigeon. And the one that we have in the United States is typically the domesticated pigeon. These are pigeons that have been captive and bred captively and then were intentionally or accidentally released, forming feral populations all around the United States. And in terms of where they're originally from, so pigeons lived on these rocky cliffs. So you can imagine something kind of like the Grand Canyon, but in Southern Europe and North Africa and the Middle East. And they're nesting on all those little shelves within that cliff, within that canyon. And that that provides protection. It provides them an easy access to fly away. If a predator comes in, they can fly away into that canyon. So that's native, what they look like in their native habitat.
Okay, great answer. Let's go to folks out in the audience. Let's go to Susan from Tracy, California, who has a question about how shoebills see. Right, Susan, go ahead.
Hi, yeah, I've looked at some images on the internet of shoebills, and I always noticed that their eyes are so emotional, just arresting, almost give you a sense that they're sad or they're, I don't know, they're enchanting. So what do we know about the vision of the shoebill?
Yes, so the shoebill uses binocular vision, and most of the times they'll stand still and motionless for 20 or more minutes or even an hour. So when they're hunting, they keep They keep a stare. So the stare is intense. When you look at them in the eyes, the stare is intense. So when they're hunting, they'll either stand and wait for the prey and then they strike, or they will wade and walk slowly within the same area as they wait for prey to strike at the right time. So the eyes, I wouldn't say it's something intimidating or sad, but it's probably the way they have adopted, or the way they were created. And the intense stare also works largely as a defense mechanism. So if you encountered someone for the first time and they gave you such eyes, and you were the bad guy, you would definitely walk away.
That's what I do to Ira when he gets too off topic during an interview. We have another audience question about shoebill storks. This one, actually Barbara from Kentucky has, I think, a couple questions about shoebill storks. Why don't you start with your first one, Barbara?
Since shoebills are so large, where do they nest?
Yeah, I'd like to know that.
So shoebills nest within their wetland habitat, and the nest can measure up to 1 meter diameter. The nest is composed of a few sticks and grass. So the nesting is usually done at the start of the dry season to avoid water sweeping away the nests. So they either put the nests on small islands within the wetland, or create a platform of vegetation, the floating vegetation on top, then they make the nest.
Interesting, great question. I didn't know that. It's kind of nice to know that. Elizabeth, question for you about pigeons. I mean, we see pigeons all over the place. And in most cases, when you see a pigeon, at least on the streets of New York or big cities, you hardly see one pigeon by itself, right? You see a whole bunch of pigeons together. Are they social creatures? Do they travel in flocks or packs or whatever you'd call them on the street there?
They are very social creatures. And part of that is it allows them to feed, but also have individuals looking out for predators that might come by. And so by having a bunch of individuals in a group, you can have some pigeons looking for predators and being kind of aware of the surroundings while the other ones are feeding, and then switch off. And they also, kind of weird pigeon facts, they will mate for life. So maybe not always mate with the same, pigeons are not necessarily monogamous, but they will continue to go back to that same mate and continue to mate with that same individual throughout their lives. And so that pair bonding is kept up through all these interesting behaviors that you might see, such as the male pigeon will kind of puff out his chest and do a couple of spins for the female to court her. And that is going on throughout the year when they're mating or when they're not mating, just to keep up that pair bond. So part of that flocking together is to, as protection, and then part of it is pair bonds that are occurring with another individual.
We've been hearing about how patient a bird the shoebill stork is, you know, in their interesting hunting behavior that Judith was telling us about. Perhaps the opposite of a patient bird, maybe the pigeon, just based on walking through a park in New York City and seeing them swarm a person who is eating a sandwich. But what they lack in manners may be remedied by the fact that I think they might be one a little bit smarter than people realize. Our nominator, Greg, said that they're, in his opinion, one of the most intelligent animals on the planet. I don't know if that is exactly true, but that's a pretty good argument. And he said that they can recognize words and themselves in a mirror. I mean, Elizabeth, are pigeons smarter than we give them credit for?
I think they're definitely smarter than we give them credit for. Intelligence is obviously a complicated question, and things are evolved to be best suited for their environment. Brain tissue takes up all this energy. And so you could be smart in the sense that if I don't have a complex habitat, I don't need to waste energy on building all this brain tissue. In terms of pigeons, they have some pretty incredible abilities. There's been research showing that they can recognize artwork or different paintings by different artists. There's been some research showing that they may be able to recognize cancer in photographs. And they have this incredible homing sense that we don't quite understand how they're able to do this. So we know that there's these stories of pigeons kind of being these war heroes and bringing messages back to base during World War II. And so how were they able to do that? How were they able to deliver these messages back? And how are they able to find their way home? If you put me in a dark box and drove me for a couple hours and spun me around and then said, go home, I would absolutely not be able to find my way home. But these pigeons can do that. And so they have this incredible homing sense where no matter kind of where they're brought, they can return back to that natal area where they're nesting.
Quite interesting. Let me go to Griffin from Charlottesville. Griffin's, I think he's age 10. He has a question about Shoebill diet. What do Shoebills eat? Griffin, go ahead.
There we are. So I was wondering what the Shoebills eat and how much they weigh because they're such big birds.
Really good question.
Yeah, really, really good question. What's the answer to that?
So the Shoebill weigh about 4 to 5 kilograms. The males are bigger than the females. But if you don't find the males and the females, if you don't find a couple, you cannot tell between the sexes. And Shoebills eat, they feed on fish, majorly the lungfish, the African lungfish. They feed on frogs. They feed on baby crocodiles. They feed on other aquatic life.
Wow, the baby crocodiles is surprising to me.
Yeah. Wow.
We have another Shoebill question. Our audience is being great with questions today, from Stephen, who has a question about where Shoebills live. Go ahead, Stephen.
Yes, I see they live in Africa only. Are they expanding their range any bit?
Are their Shoebill stork ranges changing, Judith?
I would say no. So Shoebills are very specific and selective of habitats. So they majorly live in freshwater wetlands. They have a bit expanded their ranges to include rice fields. So of course the rice fields have the water, they are flooded, they have plenty of food for them, like the frogs, the toads, and all the other water snakes. So they are majorly found in Africa because the water in Africa is still fresh. So if you look at all the countries that I mentioned, all those are freshwater lakes and they have freshwater rivers and streams. Yeah. Of course, the Shoebills are not migratory. They only make short movements to look for food, suitable habitats, nesting sites. But they don't, you cannot compare them to, for example, the Palearctic migrants that probably they'll make long flights from Africa to Europe. And yeah.
Very interesting. A question about homing pigeons for you, Elizabeth. I mean, we all know we've heard about homing pigeons. You mentioned just before how good they are of being disoriented, so to speak, in a box, and then they can get up and go home. Do we know the biology of how, do they have something in their brains or how they know how to get home?
So scientists are thinking that it's probably a combination of things. There's been some interesting experiments, some fun experiments where they put magnets on the brain or try to blind, like little blindfolds on the pigeons, and the pigeons are still able to get home. So what they're probably doing is a bunch of different things, potentially using the Earth's magnetic field, using visual cues and using kind of sense cues to home in back on that location. This is also why people have kind of such a hard time getting rid of pigeons that may be nesting on their AC unit. They can keep, if you get that pigeon away, you can capture it, you can move it away, it's going to come back home. That's its home on your AC unit outside your window.
Well, that explains that.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we are about out of time here. So it's time for both of you to give your final arguments for why your creature is the most charismatic of the day. Elizabeth, let's start with you. Why do you love pigeons so much? Why are they the most charismatic creature of this matchup?
For me, pigeons are this great model for evolution. We've been studying them since Darwin. They help Darwin kind of understand selection. And for those of you out there that haven't Googled curly pigeons, please do go and look at what a curly pigeon looks like. There are these really fascinating curly feathers all over the pigeon. And they kind of show this wild amount of traits that can be bred into animals when we're doing these selective breedings and these crazy things that evolution can do. I think they're this animal that lives alongside us. And while many might consider them a pest, I think we would be sad if they disappeared from our cities. I think back to TV shows, whenever they want to show urbanization, they'll show a flock of pigeons taking off as the little bumper in between scenes. And so they really are this symbol of human community and togetherness. We release pigeons at weddings. We release these white pigeons at weddings to celebrate love. And they are this giant group of really charismatic, happy individuals.
Wow, that's some defense, Judith. It's, you're going to have to be able to match that for your final defense of the Shoebill Stork. Tell us about why you think the Shoebill Stork should win this competition. What is it about the bird that you love so much?
So I don't know. I just love the Shoebill. So the Shoebill is the most charismatic of them all because it is big. It is the only member of its family in Balaeniceptidae. So if we lost a Shoebill, that is losing a whole family. That is one. Two, the Shoebill is globally threatened all over the world because it is faced by many threats majorly brought about by human disturbance, such as habitat loss, fishing, hunting for pets and zoo trade. Like a Shoebill, a Shoebill can cost up to $20,000 for someone purchasing it simply to put it in a zoo or keep it for their own entertainment. The other bit about the Shoebill is they are solitary. And then the breeding, the Shoebills lay 1 to 2 eggs, and in rare cases may lay 3 eggs, and with as much of an interval as 5 days. So the first chick tends to hatch out faster since incubation starts right away from when the first egg is laid. And this chick becomes aggressive and stronger because of the competition for resources. These chicks tend to kill off the weaker ones. So normally only one will fledge to maturity. So the numbers keep low, even because of the breeding behavior of the Shoebill. It's not like any other bird which lay about 10 to 20 eggs or 30 eggs. And of course, the dependence rate of the young ones on the parents is quite unique. They depend on the parents for quite some time. So Yeah, we cannot lose the shoebill, or else we'll never see a comparison of a dinosaur. Since the dinosaur is gone, we have to keep the shoebill. Yeah, thank you.
That's a very convincing argument for me, at least.
Wow.
I think so.
Okay, Ira, we're out of time here. Do you think our listeners have enough information to make a decision about which creature they think is the most charismatic?
Wow, such great cases brought for each one. Wow, so the great arguments. I think they do. So how do people vote? Let's get into that now.
So our listeners can go to sciencefriday.com/carnival, sciencefriday.com/carnival to cast your vote. You have until next Wednesday at 10 a.m. Eastern time to choose your favorite in this matchup. Will the shoebill stork or the pigeon come out on top? That is up to you, the listeners.
And I don't think there's any way we can predict how our listeners vote if we take our history as any case, right? So,
just before we go, I just have one more video to play for you.
The shoebills
are silent, and they only clutter their bills as a form of greeting. So this is me saying bye, and thank you for listening to me and giving me a chance. Yeah. Although they are there, but they don't enjoy the video.
One face is north, one face is south.
Very interesting. So it's dangerous to actually keep shoebills together.
I think that's our best outro we've ever had for our charismatic creature carnival.
Wow. Wow, what an actual goodbye there. That was great. Thank you. Thank you, Judith. Judith Mirembe, shoebill researcher and chair of Uganda Women Birders based in Kampala, Uganda. Also, Elizabeth Carlen, postdoctoral research fellow at Washington University in St. Louis. Thank you for making some great arguments for your birds. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having us.